priesthood and in the diaconate, seminarians, consecrated religious sisters and brothers, knights and ladies of the Holy Sepulchre of Jerusalem, other knights of Columbus, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ. As we gather here in this beautiful, magnificent cathedral of the Immaculate Conception, our minds and thoughts of many of us are on another cathedral thousands of miles away, the Cathedral of Notre Dame in Paris, which was ravaged and gutted by fire over the last couple of days. Even for those who have never been to Paris, many people are familiar with the Cathedral of Notre Dame because of those wonderful videos put together by Bishop Robert Barron, the Catholicism series, in which he features many churches in Paris, including the Cathedral of Notre Dame. I had the privilege of getting a personal tour of the Cathedral of Notre Dame about 30 years ago from then Father Robert Barron. We were both priests of the Archdiocese of Chicago. He was doing his graduate studies in theology at the Institut Catholique in Paris. I was doing my graduate studies in canon law at the Pontifical Gregorian University. And one year, on my way back home, I did a stop with a layover in Paris for a few days and had a personal tour of much of Paris from Bob Barron. And looking back, it was sort of a prelude, almost a forerunner. Perhaps from that he got the idea to do this Catholicism series, because he basically walked me through the Cathedral of Notre Dame the way he does in the Catholicism video, and explained all the architecture and the windows, the beautiful rose window. And so, you know, for those of us, whether we saw it in person or on the videos, it is heartbreaking to see the destruction and the damage to this magnificent cathedral. But I have great hope that this cathedral will be rebuilt. I have hope not only because the President of France has said they will rebuild, and many people have already pledged millions of dollars to that effort. I also have hope basically because I grew up in Chicago. And even though the Great Chicago Fire of 1871 happened a long time before I was born, anyone growing up in Chicago pretty much has the Great Chicago Fire burned into his psyche, so to speak. And so growing up, we studied, of course, and learned about the Great Chicago Fire and the anecdotes and stories related to that, including the various debates about how that fire started. But regardless of how it started, we also learned the story of a Jesuit priest by the name of Father Arnold Damon, who was the pastor of Holy Family Church in Chicago, and not far from where the fire started. And he prayed that the church would be spared. And miraculously, the winds blew the flames around Holy Family Church. That church still stands today next to St. Ignatius High School, while the rest of the city burned. Even years later, as an adult in Chicago and running along the lakefront doing my marathon training for many, many miles, I was always very aware of the fact that what we know now as Grant Park is basically landfill from debris from the Great Chicago Fire. If you ever wondered why the buildings stop at Michigan Avenue, there are no buildings east of Michigan Avenue, is because that's where the city stopped. Michigan Avenue was on the shore of Lake Michigan. There was no Grant Park, there was no Lakeshore Drive. That is a result of the Great Chicago Fire. And so anyone who's been to Chicago and see the beautiful lakefront and the architecture of that city, all of that in a sense is because it rose up out of the ashes. And the reason also why the seal, the emblem of the Archdiocese of Chicago is a phoenix, a legendary bird that rises up out of the ashes. And so I have this great hope that the Cathedral of Notre Dame will indeed be rebuilt and rise up out of the ashes. But I also have great hope that this rebuilding of the Cathedral of Notre Dame will not be just the rebuilding of a physical structure, but also a rebuilding of the church, of the people, of France, and the Catholicism in that great country, and not only there, but throughout the world. I'm reminded of St. Francis of Assisi, who prayed before our Lord's crucifix at the Church of San Damiano and heard the Lord say to him, "Rebuild my church." And he thought he was praying and telling him about this physical structure of the church around him, which indeed was in disrepair. And so he set out to fix it. And then along the line, and his prayer eventually realized that the Lord was calling him not just to rebuild the physical structure of the church, but to rebuild the community of the church. My friends, this is, I think, the challenge for all of us as we pray for the people of Paris and the people of France, that we also, of course, need to look at ourselves and our own situation. That we here in the United States and in other parts of the world have been rocked by scandals and shocking stories about the sins of clergy and the hierarchy over the past several months. And so in many ways, we too have our church in shambles that needs to be rebuilt. But I also have great hope and confidence that we can do that. And basically, it is through the scriptures that we read during this Holy Week where we can get a blueprint of that plan for us of how to rebuild the church. Looking at the scriptures this week, starting with the Passion narrative on Palm Sunday, reading through that, it starts with the institution narrative of the Last Supper. And as a bishop, being a successor of the apostles, I perhaps pay a little more attention to what the apostles were doing on these occasions. And at the beginning of Luke's gospel, in those first few paragraphs, when he's describing that Last Supper, which in effect was the first Eucharist being concelebrated by Jesus the high priest with his bishops, we see Jesus talking about one of them will betray him and one of them will deny him. And then Luke tells us that while they were eating, an argument broke out amongst them as to who was the greatest. This is the first Mass being celebrated. I hope you won't start arguing amongst yourselves during this liturgy tonight. But what happens after that Last Supper? Luke tells us that Jesus goes out to pray and invites his apostles to come with him and says, "Stay with me, stay awake and pray." And what happens? They fall asleep. Now, I say all that, and then also looking at the scriptures for this week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, the readings for the daily masses of this week all feature Judas. They talk about Judas and his plotting and his bargaining to get a cash reward with the Jewish authorities. Judas objecting to the spending of money on oil, this oil, perfumed oil that will be used to anoint Jesus' feet. And the gospel writer tells us it's not because he was really so concerned for the poor, but because he was a thief and he used to steal from the treasury. This is Jesus' hand-picked treasurer. And so what do we see with all these stories during Holy Week of these chosen men, chosen by our Lord to be the leaders of the church and upon which he will build the church with Peter as the rock. And this rock is the one, of course, who denies him. What do we learn from all this? Well, we learn, for one thing, the great love and mercy and compassion of our Lord. That despite these sins, he dies on the cross for all of us, for all of our sins. And not just the apostles, but even down to the thief hanging on the cross next to him, who begs for mercy, and Jesus says, "You will be with me this day in paradise." And then he even forgives his executioner, saying, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." And so that gives us great consolation. But lest we slip into a sort of complacency or rationalization or presumption and saying, well, it's okay if I'm sinful because those apostles were weak and sinful too. God will forgive me. No, we have to look deeper and see what happened when those apostles, when they sinned. Judas, of course, apparently recognized his sin, but didn't recognize the saving power of Christ, and so he kills himself. Peter, when he realizes what he had done in denying our Lord, doesn't sort of sit back and say, oh, well, that's too bad, but he'll forgive me. He says, he realizes the sinfulness, and the Bible tells us that he wept bitterly. My brothers in the priesthood and the diaconate, my brothers and sisters in Christ, when we see our sins, we should weep bitterly and not fall into some kind of rationalization or complacency about them. We should weep bitterly that we will never commit those sins again. And that's the real story of this Holy Week. Because those weak, sinful, frail men on whom Jesus would build his church at the beginning of all this, that passion narrative, are so seemingly unsuited for the task. By the time Jesus rises from the dead, they're completely different. They're completely changed. And they're alive and on fire with the Spirit. And they go out and they change the world by proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. In our scriptures today, we hear from the prophet Isaiah the passage about being the anointed one on whom the Spirit rests, and says that all those on whom, those who are anointed will be called priests. And then in the scripture passage from the gospel, we have Jesus quoting from this passage in Isaiah and saying, that applies to me, declaring himself to be the anointed one, which in Hebrew translates to the Messiah, and in Greek, Christos, Christ, the anointed one. And that's why they wanted to kill him, because he was saying that he was the Messiah. Of course, now we recognize that he is indeed the Messiah. He is the anointed one. And it's important for us to keep that in mind today, of all days, at this Chrism Mass, when we have the blessing and the consecration of these oils. For the last several weeks, I've been going around our diocese visiting parishes for confirmation masses. I get a little respite here during this week. I'm going to pick up the confirmation trail again next week for the next several weeks. And as you priests know, when I come to a parish, I always meet with the confirmandi and have a little talk with them before Mass and explain the symbols that we use in our vestments and the articles used by a priest. But I also talk to them about these oils and the symbolism of the oil, which is good for us to call to mind here today as we bless these oils. I start out by talking about the ancient Olympics centuries ago. What does that have to do with the oils? Well, it was in those ancient Olympics that the athletes used to take olive oil, very abundant in Greece, where those first Olympic Games were played, and they would rub the olive oil on their bodies like liniment to make their muscles loose and their ligaments limber, to make them stronger athletes. And so we use oil for, we use olive oil for, and all of these sacred oils, but we use olive oil and we bless it for the sick, because in the sacrament of the sick, we are praying for strength for people who need physical, spiritual, and emotional strength to deal with their sickness. The oil of catechumens we use for people who are preparing to be baptized, because they need spiritual strength to be able to confront and resist the temptations of the devil, who will try to divert them from their path, who will do everything in his power to keep them from becoming holy, from becoming saints. And we use that oil in the sacred chrism, not only for the consecration of people, but even places. When the Cathedral of Notre Dame is rebuilt, it will be anointed by its bishop, the altar and the church, just as this altar and church were anointed 10 years ago when it was rededicated. But people too are anointed. We use that oil at baptism and confirmation and in holy orders. And all of those anointings tie us to Christ. It's baptism, of course, that makes us sons and daughters of God and his family, but it's the anointing that comes right after the baptism. It's the anointing that comes at consecration that fills us with the Holy Spirit and ties us to the anointing with Christ. And in a very special way, the anointing of the priest's hands by the bishop consecrates him for the celebration of the Eucharist and the administration of the sacraments. And the pouring of the oil on a bishop's head at his consecration unites him also in a very special way with Christ, the Anointed One, our High Priest. And so we are reminded that we share in that eternal High Priest of Jesus Christ. All of us, the priesthood of the laity, and in a special way, the ministerial priesthood of the ordained priests. And so as I call upon you priests in a few minutes to renew your commitment as priests, it's an important commitment, important promise to make in terms of pledging yourself to fulfill, to continue to fulfill the things that you promised on the day of your ordination. But I ask you today in a special way to see this, your pledge of commitment, as also uniting yourself through that anointing of the Anointed One, the Christos, our Messiah. The ceremonial for bishops says that this Chrism Mass, in a special way, is to manifest the bond of communion and unity between the bishop and his priests. Because we are co-workers, we are collaborators, you are witnesses to that outpouring of the Holy Spirit that takes place and the consecration of the chrism and the blessing of the oils today. And it is sharing, you sharing, not just in my priesthood and my being a bishop, but me with you all together, sharing in the priesthood of our great High Priest. That is the priesthood that we celebrate today. That is the priesthood that we celebrate on Good Friday. Our Lord's giving of himself, the sacrifice of himself out of love for us. And it is that priesthood that we will celebrate with the glorious resurrection of our Lord on this Easter Sunday. May God give us this grace. Amen.